I hope it's audible.
Yeah, it's audible.
So, we welcome you to the last session of our ECHO Season 6 Foundation course. Today, Sunil sir.
So today we are having a very important session, especially for those who are planning to start a new palliative care program. So the session will be dealt by Mr. Binod Hariharan. So Mr. Binod is basically an engineering graduate, and he is chairman of two companies now, and he has been working with Palliative India since its beginning, and now he is one of the trustees of Palliative India, and he has good experience in how to organize palliative care. I'm Mr. Binod Hariharan, and it's over to you.
Thank you, Sunil. So, very good afternoon to all of you. Am I audible? Hello?
Yeah, you are audible.
Okay. So, I understand this is the last day, last session. So, this is what happens when an engineer wants to talk to a medical professional, you know. We get sidelined. We are asked to come at the end. So, but I try to make the best out of it, and let's see if it can be made interesting for all of you. So, as you see, the topic itself is organizing palliative care services. Now, what is its relevance? You know, you are mostly doctors. I believe all of you are doctors, right? So, as a doctor, if you are an MBBS graduate, before joining, taking up your career in one of the hospitals or wherever you decide to work, you never think of organizing medical care services. I mean, you don't have to worry about that part, right? You know that you get out of college, you have your degree, and then you're getting into a facility where everything is set up for you. Like, for example, you have nurses, you have operation theaters, you have OP consulting rooms, and whatever, the wards, everything else. Now, when you talk about palliative care services, things are slightly different, I guess. Because how many of you, I mean, you can raise your hand, how many of you have known about or had some background about palliative care services prior to attending this course? How many of you have heard about it or known about it? Can you raise your hands? No, I can see only two. Hello. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Sweta. So that is, I guess, a general situation. It is not just about you. In general, if you talk to an typical MBBS graduate who has graduated out of college recently, his response would be just the same, I'm sure. So if you're not aware about palliative care or what you're going to provide, even after finishing your medical education, can you imagine what it would be like for a hospital owner or someone who is running a medical care facility? What would be his background information or knowledge about palliative care? Now, which means wherever you're going to work, if you want to work in palliative care, I am sure that at least 90% of the cases the institution where you are going will have no background of palliative care, no idea about how to organize palliative care or what is involved, who all should be there, what kind of facilities should be there. So this, that is the reason. Now, if we have this CCPM course being conducted every alternate month here in Trivandrum, and when we talk to the medical professionals who undergo this training program, who have almost finished the course, like what we have done now, when we ask the same question, you know, what are the challenges that you see going forward in implementing palliative care in your facility? Interestingly, it is not about having opioids, or it is not about having a knowledge of palliative care, it is not about the capability of treating a patient or giving them the service. The challenge, the main challenges that they see are in other areas. In other areas, when I say other areas, it is about their concerns are mainly around how do I convince the hospital management to offer palliative care as a service, as part of their regular set of services. How do I convince other doctors, other specialists in my hospital about the need for palliative care? How do I convince or talk to a patient who is there with a specialist undergoing aggressive treatment to look at end of life options? You know, those kind of things. And how do I make the management provide me with other facilities? Like, for example, if I need to do home care, what about travel services, travel facilities, or anything that is related to the basic infrastructure, human resources, all those things. Now, that and a lot of these services are also connected to money. Because only if you have money can you think of implementing most of these things. So the way we see it, can I have the next slide? It boils down to three or four core areas. You can just go ahead. So it's the questions are mostly around volunteers, collaborating with other entities, advocacy and fundraising. Now, why advocacy and fundraising has been put together is because they go hand in hand. So when we go into the details, you'll also understand that when you do advocacy work, it helps fundraising, and when you do some fundraising activity, it also helps advocacy. Next slide. So we start here. This is a definition. I'm sure you must be very well versed with this definition. You must have seen it in the other sessions. Someone must have talked about this. Now, yes, we all agree that it is about improving the quality of life of patients and families. It's about preventing or giving a relief to their suffering. It's about treatment of pain and other problems. All good. So my question is, next slide. Whose business is it? When I say business, it's not in the literal sense of making money or that kind of a business. Who is supposed to do this? Who is responsible for this? Now, why I ask this question is, unless we are clear that palliative care is something which each and every one of us, you and me and the general public, every one of us, is involved, or it is our business, it is our responsibility. Unless we are clear about it, many of the other things that we are going to talk about, it doesn't make sense, including me being here. Why should I, being an engineer or an engineering graduate with some management expertise, be talking to a group of doctors about palliative care and palliative care service delivery? So the answer is simple. Palliative care is as much a concern for me. It is about me as much as you or anyone else. So every one of us in the society, we are involved in it, and it is our concern. So that is the reason why I am now having a chance, an opportunity to talk to you. That's what I believe. Next slide. So if you look at the current healthcare system, we see at the top level, the macro level, we call it, the healthcare institutions. Those are the most familiar ones, that is the doctor, the hospitals, the medical colleges, the government infrastructure for providing healthcare. All that comes under the macro level, the healthcare system. And then and at the micro level, as you can see, it's always the family. It is at the micro level. If you have, for example, a fever, you are at home, the first person to actually take care of your healthcare needs is going to be your mother or your father or someone in your family. And very often we ignore that also. We think that, you know, the healthcare begins and ends with the hospital or the doctor and the nurse. So, if you are not able to get support or help, or your problem is not solved at the micro level, then we are looking at the next levels of support. Now, what we are going to focus on more is not the macro or the micro level, which we know it is there, it is already happening. A level in between, we call it the meso level. Now, this is where things become very interesting. You know, the meso level, as the name suggests, I'm sure in your vocabulary also it comes in quite often, that meso word. Next slide. Yes. Okay. This is about the general public, the aam aadmi, or the community. Now, this is a group which is often ignored, or we don't realize the true potential of this community, and that is what we call the social capital. So, as the name suggests, you know, capital means, you know, it's if you want to start an industry, if you want to start an activity, there are some things which need to be there. You need to invest upfront in infrastructure, maybe some equipment, some key resources, HR, and all those things. So to enable all this, to make this happen, you need capital. You need working capital, you need fixed capital and all that. It's a different kind of capital what we are looking at. We are talking about social capital. Now, this is lying underutilized all around us. It is there. The problem is, it's almost like a treasure box. It is locked and nobody knows where is the key. Now, our challenge is to identify the key, and once you have the key, you can unlock this social capital and it can work like magic. Now, at this point, I want to also highlight, we all have heard about the Kerala model of palliative care. Now, what is so special about the Kerala model? Why is it that the world is looking at Kerala as a model? Is because here we had something very unique which happened a few years back. When I say a few years back, in 92-93, when the whole palliative care movement started off in Calicut. So what happened was, until that point, palliative care was something which was available, or which people thought was feasible to be implemented only in a developed country, or where there are enough of resources to take care of the basic healthcare needs of people, then only we can think about implementing palliative care. Now, nobody never ever imagined that, you know, such a thing was possible in a country like India, where the healthcare needs, you know, are never met. We are nowhere near the global standards, and whichever parameter you look at. Now, and the requirements, the financial commitment and other resources that are required to meet the palliative care needs are much, much more, than what the current system, when I say the current system, that includes the corporate hospitals and the government hospitals or other facilities combined can offer. Now, one thing that happened in Calicut was the community got involved, and that changed everything. Whatever was thought impossible or impractical in a government setting, or for that matter in the Indian context or a developing world context, everything was made possible just because the community got involved. And that is where we are going to spend a little bit of time, and it's all about unlocking the social capital, and that is where we have the volunteers step in and make a difference. Yeah, next slide. So this gentleman, his name is K.N. Nair. He is a volunteer with us for quite some time now, few years. Just to give a brief background, he retired from the army. He retired in 92. And in 2002, his wife was diagnosed with cancer, stage 3. Now, in between, what had happened was, she was having a lot of medical complaints, and he used to carry her to different hospitals or take her to different hospitals. He, consulted a lot of medical professionals, specialists, oncologists. And it was only in 2002 that someone suggested that she undergo a pap smear test. And by the time this diagnosis was made, it was a difficult situation. It was reversible, and obviously the doctors, the usual this thing, nothing more can be done. That is what the feedback that he was given. Now, I just want you to imagine yourself in his position. How you would have reacted to a situation where you have been taking your wife to, or taking your wife or husband or your loved one to the doctors, to different healthcare facilities, and in the end they diagnose something and say that nothing more can happen. Now, for me, I would feel terrible. Multiple reasons, of course. The initial this thing would be anger. I would be obviously angry at the whole system. I'd be angry at the doctors, the hospitals, and which you see quite often, right? So people getting angry at this whole system and then reacting to it. And often it is, the doctors also face some of it at least once in a while. I'm sure you must have experienced it also at some point of time or the other, I'm not sure. Anyway. Now, that is just the initial reaction. Now, after that, there are so many other emotions that you go through. Like, for example, in his case, what he said was, he was feeling guilty. Now, he has done all that he could. He has taken his wife to all the best medical facilities, to the doctors, but still he was feeling guilty. I'm sure you can imagine why he would feel guilty after doing all this. Because at that moment, he realized that, okay, if I had taken her to this doctor who asked her to undergo that test, maybe it would have been identified earlier. If I had taken her to maybe a better healthcare facility where, this could have been identified earlier, I could have saved her life. So that is on one side. Plus, to top it all, the reaction, the first reaction from the doctor, which is typically, you know, why didn't you bring her here earlier? In fact, that actually happened in this case. Now, there is a self-inflicted all these feelings, plus on top of that, from the doctor, you get to hear this. Now imagine how you would react. You know, what is the course of action that you would decide to take in such a situation? If I were in this position, you know, probably I would have decided to fight it out, you know. And she died, in fact, in I think 2 years later, 2004, he died. She died. I would have probably taken it up with a legal expert, you know, fought it out. Or I would have gone to the hospital and made a big issue out of it. Those were options for him as well. But what he decided was something different, you know. He decided, you know, if my wife had gone through this and, you know, she has suffered because of lack of the proper diagnosis or lack of proper support, I have to make sure that no one else faces such a situation or another person doesn't end up in the situation. Let me do my part. And there a volunteer is born. Now, this is one example where a person, because of his life experiences, takes a decision that, yes, let me use the remaining time that I have with me, the remaining years, in making sure that people who are suffering get some relief due to the work that I am doing. Now, if you look closely, the reason why I narrated this story about K. Nair is that we talk about volunteers all the time. Every person who is thinking about palliative care or setting up a palliative care facility, the first thing on their mind is, how can I get volunteers to support me? Now, we have to understand that these kind of volunteers are all around us. There are hundreds of them and probably thousands of them. But the problem is, it's very difficult to identify them. If you go searching for them, you will never find them. Now, what is the alternative? The only option is for them to come find you. Now, K. N. Nair came to Pallium India. Pallium India did not go to K. N. Nair. And why did he come to us? It is just because he felt with us, working with us, he could reach out to the set of people who are suffering and he could contribute to the society. So we have to understand, next slide. Before we talk about volunteers, we have to understand what volunteer is, now how a person becomes a volunteer, or what makes him tick, essentially. So if you go by the definition, a volunteer is someone who takes up a task or responsibility without, you know, someone asking him or her to do something. You know, there is no one to order or make a volunteer do things, and it will never work that way. Also, if you try to make a volunteer do things which he is not convinced about, he will never do it. Why? Basically, because there is no compensation connected with this, in the sense monetary compensation. Of course, we are all selfish human beings. As long as we are humans, we have our own selfish interests. And definitely there is something in it for people like Ken Meyer, and any volunteer for that matter. I'm not saying they're selfless and totally service-oriented. But the thing is, it's not definitely not the money that can entice them and make them do more things. So it is important to understand what makes them tick. And of course, to before we actually involve them, we also should be clear about their role in palliative care. Now, we'll go through some of the possible areas where, you know, they could help in the service delivery. But imagination is the limit. You know, we could look at a few critical aspects or something which we have seen, but then that may not be the only areas where they can contribute. Can I have the next slide? So, as I said, it is important to understand what makes them do it. What makes the Kane Nair do it? Next. And what are they looking for? What are they looking out for from this involvement when they get involved in the patient care activities or palliative care activities? What is it that they're looking forward to? And only when we understand these two things, you know, then only we'll be in a position to offer them something which is of value to them. We must again remember here that it is not the money that is going to be interesting for them. So what else? So if we understand what is it that they're looking for, then maybe we are in a position to offer them something which is really interesting. Next. And unless they are able to offer something of interest to them, sorry about that, we will not be able to keep them happy. And if they are not happy, you know what is going to happen. It's unlike a job where in a corporate hospital or a company where you get a salary which ensures that you can take care of your family. Here, a volunteer is coming in to make sure that he is contributing, helping the society, making sure that people get some benefit out of it. And because of which, unless he is happy and contented in what he is doing, we will not be able to maintain him or make him happy and contributing. Now, the possible areas of support. Of course, patient care. When I say patient care, there are a lot of aspects within patient care. So would someone like to suggest some of the areas where you feel a volunteer would be able to help or support? Anyone? You can raise your hand or... Yeah. You're muted, I guess.
A volunteer can help patient's family by providing or providing medicines from nearby hospitals, like then in wound management, dressing. A volunteer can help.
Okay.
For transportation, taking the patient, patient who require a more frequent visit to hospitals, they can help.
Okay. You are right. There was one other suggestion. What was that in between we saw that?
Dr. Jyoti said creating social awareness.
Yeah, creating social awareness. Now, yes, you are right. I mean, all this plus, I think the most important aspect is, yes, I think Jyoti has got it right. See, what is that? Can you just move it? It's about helping identify patients needing palliative care. Now, that is one major thing, one major element. You know, you have learned all about palliative care, how you can help someone in need and all those things. But what if you don't have the patient in front of you? And most often what happens is, because the patients have been asked by the hospital or the doctor, or told by them that, you know, there is nothing more that can be done. And you're asked to go home and, sorry, Sorry, there is a power outage here. Okay, so unless they are made to realize that there are options, you know, when a hospital or a doctor has said, you know, there is nothing more that can be done, we have to reach out, you know, someone has to reach out to them and let them know that there are options available which they could explore, through which they can probably manage their the situation better, the quality of life can be improved. Now, the problem is most of these people are at home, they are bedridden or at least homebound, I would say. So, to connect with them, one of the most important roles that a volunteer can play is identifying the patient in need and bring them to us or help us reach out to them. Basically, we are talking about the link between the healthcare facility and the patient. Now, as I said, it's even more important in palliative care because they don't know that they can go out and reach out to a healthcare facility where they can get some kind of support. Okay. And of course, the other things what you said is absolutely relevant. That is, you know, you can provide psychosocial support. A lot of the activities that a hospital or a typical healthcare facility might find it difficult to do. Like, for example, there are situations where the family would be in such a situation that they cannot even afford 2 square meals a day. Now, whatever kind of healthcare support that you are giving them, if they cannot have food, basic food, none of the medical support is relevant, right? So who can make sure that there is sufficient food available for the family to survive on? So even a food kit makes a huge difference, and these are areas where volunteers can play a big role, and they are playing a major role throughout the state and in certain parts, other parts of the country as well. Now, when I say that, you know, it is about identifying patients and providing psychosocial support, we shouldn't be, we shouldn't limit ourselves in our thinking, because the sky is the limit. It is all about, one, the capability of the volunteer, their skill set, and second, their interest in doing something, you know. Like, for example, here we have mentioned clerical office work, fundraising, advocacy. Okay, we'll come to advocacy and all that. You know what I mean by advocacy? It is about popularizing the concept, growing and meeting people, or, you know, letting the public know that more about the palliative care services availability and all those things. But here in Palli in India, we have always had our treasurer. When I say treasurer, this is a trust. This is a public charitable trust. And for us, the treasurer is the person who is in charge or in control of the entire funds. So you can imagine what an important role that person is supposed to play. Now, if you are spending 1 rupee out of the funds that we have, it has to be cleared by the treasurer. He is the person who has to take a decision whether we need to get into an activity, get to stop an activity, do more about something, or whatever it is. And the financial thing, you know, the whole control is with him. And for all the while, right from the beginning in Palli in India, we have had a volunteer be a treasurer. What does that mean? If we can think beyond limitations, they'll be able to plug into any kind of role that the organization needs. It's only about us letting them in. Often we are hesitant to do that, but if we can let them in, you know, the lot of things that they can do for us. And when I say do for us, we have to be mindful of the fact that they are not doing these things for the organization. It is not about doing things for Pally Media. For them, what is important is reaching out to the public, the common man on the street who is a patient or a family who needs support. And they just seeing us or Pally Media or another organization, one of your organizations probably, as a vehicle or a means to reach out to these people in need. So whenever they feel that, you know, that this is one way of helping the community, they'll be with us. The moment they feel that we are not doing our job properly, they will start focusing on some other organization or try to do something else on their own. So we'll lose them eventually. So one other thing is, you know, it's not just important that we identify the volunteers, but it's also important that we get specific commitment from them as far as the time of the day that would be available, they would be available, or the number of days they would be available, because only then we'll be also able to plan accordingly. You know, if they are involved in patient care, there are a lot of things that they can do. But if they are not available on specific days or specific time slots, we may not be able to plan accordingly, which means, you know, we'll be wasting their time and our time. Okay. So when you're looking at volunteer management, we need to screen volunteers. It is just about, it is similar to identifying the staff to support you. Now, critical questions that we should definitely be asking would be, does this person have the necessary skills, qualifications, and commitment to do what he's supposed to do? We can also have them go through a formal process of application and interview and all those things. May not be very practical initially when you're starting off, but then it could be an informal process also. But then there has to be definitely an interview process where you get to know each other, your needs and aspirations, all those things has to be shared. And last but not the least, very important, they need to undergo a formal training. Why I am saying it is important is because the intention may be good. Their intentions may be to help the patient or the family. But if they're not given the proper training, it may backfire. In the sense, you know, what they're doing may ultimately harm the patient and the family rather than helping them. Now, that is a case not just with volunteers. It is applicable to anyone who is involved in healthcare, in palliative care. Be it nurses, doctors, social workers, or whatever. So we need to give them the necessary training. Maybe they don't need to get trained as much as a doctor or a nurse, but then still there are basic communication skills which they need to learn. There are the do's and don'ts which they need to strictly follow. Those are things which we need to reiterate while we are giving them the proper training. And they need to be supervised and evaluated. So that again can be a continuous process where they also share their experiences. They come out and say whether they are enjoying what they're doing, whether they feel it is worthwhile spending the time with us. Similarly, we also have to evaluate whether this person is contributing, helping us with the patient care or whatever activities that we want them to be involved in. So, I think we'll just talk for a moment with the volunteers. So there are three other areas which we need to cover, but any questions around volunteering, I'd be happy to take that at this moment.
So volunteering is a new area for us, because we are working in a hospital where we see only hospital staffs. But now in palliative care, we are seeing many volunteers who want to work with palliative care. So you can ask any doubts about other roles, or you can ask anything about volunteers now to Binod.
One question to you, Amin. Has any one of you worked with a volunteer in any of the organizations that you work, or maybe while you were studying? Or have any one of you volunteered for an organization yourself?
Unmute yourself and speak, otherwise you can give your optional chat.
Yeah, and language is also not a barrier. But not in the health sector. Jyoti, okay, I'm curious to know which sector you are involved in, so at least one person has had some experience volunteering. And how is it? I mean, did you enjoy that whole process or the activity? Jyoti? Is someone trying to speak?
Jyoti says yes, it was a new experience.
Okay. So I believe, apart from Jyoti, nobody else has actually worked with a volunteer or volunteered themselves. So, like Dr. Sunil was mentioning, this is probably a new experience for many of you. And what we have seen is, you know, that can change, that can help you and us a lot in the palliative care sector, because they represent the community. They can make us reach out to the public and the community much easier. Since there are no questions, Dr. Sunil, shall we go forward?
Yeah, I think we can cover the other areas.
Yeah. So one other area, now why we've included this collaboration here is things are changing. Things are changing at a rapid pace. Now earlier when we talk about palliative care, it was something which was being offered by a few NGOs primarily, on probably a few individuals or CDOs, as we call it. Now, it is changing rapidly. And it is imperative that we work with other entities, other organizations, other groups, individuals, so that, you know, we can make this movement more effective. You know, palliative care being an area where we don't have...
You know, can we have 1 minute? Dr. Amalu has a doubt.
Yes.
She's asking whether volunteers need any specific qualifications.
Okay. They don't need any specific qualification to be a volunteer, but it all depends on what kind of work you want them to be involved in. Now, if you want them to get involved in, say, nursing care, of course, that person needs to have the nursing background, or he or she should be trained in nursing. And mind you, you know, when we talk about volunteers, there could be doctors and nurses also involved as volunteers. Now, if you want someone to look at accounts, like in our case, you know, the treasurer, definitely the treasurer needs to know or have good background in accounting, right? So if he doesn't have that background, the qualification required to handle that particular activity, it is dangerous. You know, we should never look at offering that kind of responsibility to such a volunteer. But there are areas where we could provide them with the basic training. I'll give you an example. Like, for example, there are situations where just a visit, regular home visit by a volunteer to an elderly couples or even an elderly person staying alone, maybe once in a week or once or twice a week can make a huge difference, you know, because that person is alone and no one to talk to. There are his psychological, social needs are there, and if a properly trained basic training, someone with basic training is able to go visit them once in a while, that can make a world of difference for the patient, right? So there are areas where some basic training can be helpful even without specific qualification, but then there are some areas where they need to have the necessary background and qualifications to provide that kind of support.
Binod, can I make a comment?
Oh yes, sure, go ahead.
Yeah. Any person with interest in palliative care are welcome in palliative care. For a volunteer, there are many roles, not only in patient care, but also in many other areas. And I know that many volunteers, they come to a palliative care organization or palliative care center where somebody will help in cleaning the rooms, and somebody will make coffee, and somebody will help in administration, and some person may help with finding out what are the patient's problems, and some are interested to finding out money for the organization. So there are various roles. So as per their wish and as per their skills, we can deploy them in various various roles in palliative care.
Thank you, Dr. Sunil. Yeah, you are absolutely right. You know, like we discussed in one of the earlier slides, they can be very effective in fundraising, advocacy, social support, you know, all those areas. So it's not that, you know, it's only in patient care that they can be involved in. So going back to collaboration, now, next. So as I said, the situation is changing. Now we have more NGOs, CBOs involved in palliative care. Plus there is the public health system, basically PHCs, CHC, etc. And of course, we are talking about a network world. We have network communities. Geographical boundaries are no longer a limit. So there could be people sitting here. You know, there was an actual this thing happening. Like there was a patient in Pakistan who required lymphedema care, and one of our nurses sitting here in Pallim, India, over the net, provided training to the caregiver or the nurse on how to do the lymphedema care. And a week or a month, the patient got tremendous relief, and she wanted to come visit us here in Trivandrum. Now, what I'm trying to say is, it no longer, geographical boundaries also do not matter nowadays. So there are so many people who are out there who are committed to the cause, who are providing palliative care. Now it's about working together so that, you know, we get the best benefit for the patient and the families. Now it's easier said than done. Now, when you get into collaborative working, like here in Trivandrum, if you look at it, Palliative Media reaches out to patients directly through home visit, home care teams. We have around 5 teams. Plus, we have the inpatient facility and the OP facility. But all put together, there is always a limit to the number of patients that we can directly deal with, follow up, and all those things. So what we have chosen to do is work with other entities. Like, for example, each one of the organizations or the collaborating partner that we have, we call them a link center. So there is a link between Palliative Media and the link center. And the link center could be a CBO, another NGO, It could be, when I say CBO, it is a community-based organization. NGO is a non-government organization, which is more formal. Or it could be the government also. Like, for example, here in Government Medical College, Trivandrum, Palliative India's team goes out on a daily basis and takes care of the palliative care OP clinic. Medical college does not have a palliative care team to take care of the OP clinic. So we work with the government medical college here. They provide us the infrastructure. Their specialists or the doctors refer patients to this clinic where they feel requires help. And their community medicine doctors and other doctors, as required, they come join us, work with our team to provide the patient care. Now, what that means is for Palliative India, we are able to reach out to a larger number of people by associating with each one of these organizations. But mind you, each one of these links, each one of these network links that we're talking about, it takes time and effort to build and maintain. It is just like, you know, we talked about maintaining the relationship with a volunteer. You know, I mean, you can also imagine what would be the kind of challenges that you'd say face when you are trying to work with the government medical college in such a setting. You know, we being a probably charitable trust or an NGO working with the government machinery. So now those are the challenges that we need to deal with. As long as both of us are clear that there is the end objective is the patient and the family, there will be, there are ways and means of working together and finding solutions to the small problems that may come up. Next slide. Now I'd like to give a small example. This patient, I've changed the name, Sita. She was she underwent a surgery in a vertebral column. I don't know, there was a growth or something, I don't know the exact medical condition, because of which she had a spinal cord injury and she was paralyzed. Now, once her basic treatment, the surgery, everything was over, she was asked to go back home, and she was practically at home for quite some time before one of our link center volunteers actually got us in touch with this lady. Now, eventually it turned out that today, you can go forward, she is the only earning member of her family. She was living with her father and mother. But she lost her father a couple of years back. But the only income that the family had to support her requirements as well as the parents, it was the money that she earned through making jewelry and selling it online. Now, that is not the important part here. Why I talked about this specific lady is, a lot of things came together in making sure that she finally reached the situation where she could earn and take care of her family. First off, you know, when she was at home, naturally, she had bed sores and, you know, issues like that. So she had to be taken to a facility and provided the wound care and all those things. And once those things were taken care of, then there was the big question mark in front. What more? I mean, how do we go forward? No income for the family. How do we ensure that they are able to sustain their livelihood? Now, someone came with an idea. Okay, why don't you start making jewelry? Of course, she had the basic artistic talent. And one of the volunteers started helping her to make jewelry. And then comes the next challenge. Making jewelry is all fine, but how does it convert into money? You know, it needs to be sold. So how do we help her sell that the jewelry that is made? So then another group comes up with a proposition that, okay, why don't you start selling it online? We have the social media, which can be very helpful. And the only problem was she didn't have a computer and she did not have any background. She didn't know how to use a computer or the internet. So then, again, someone else steps in. A volunteer said, okay, I'll take care of her training. And she was given the basic training in operating the computer. And we also put up a request on our website saying that, okay, this particular person, this is the background, and she needs a computer to work from home. This is the background, and this is what she wants. A good Samaritan comes by and says, okay, I can sponsor this computer. And she had a computer at home, a laptop. In the meantime, you know, she was finding it difficult to use the wheelchair at home. You can imagine, you know, even my house where I stay, if I was bound to a wheelchair, I'm sure I'll not be able to use it inside my house because it's not wheelchair friendly. And most of our houses are not. So if she wanted to be independent or at least take care of herself within her own house, it required modifications. So the so we got involved there. We made the necessary modifications, made her house wheelchair friendly. And then the local people, of course, there was no public access, road access to her house. So the neighborhood, they were helpful. They made sure that the road was widened, probably gave away some more land, and then it was widened a bit. The panchayat got involved. They actually put a surface on this thing, you know, it was not a proper tarring, but at least something that would make the road motorable, I would say. So then you had access to the house. The house was made wheelchair friendly. There was a computer which was donated. So if you look at it, if she is able to come back to life, and now she is an inspiration for so many other people like her, other people who are paralyzed. She comes, attends all the programs that we conduct. She inspires other people to be on their own and try to do things independently. The point is, all this was made possible not just because of Palliative India. It was a combination. There's local support, local panchayat, the local neighborhood, the volunteer groups, of course, physical care and support from Palliative India or such organizations. Everything comes together, and then her life is made much easier. So again, the point I'm trying to highlight is collaborative work. If you are able to do more of that, it becomes easier for all the people involved. Each of the organizations will find it easier to support such patients and their families. So basically, we are trying to increase our productivity and have innovation. Like in this case, you know, her modifications in the house, making it wheelchair friendly, you know, laying a road to her house, all those things was made possible through the collaborative effort, and thereby the productivity also increases. But we should also understand that we are all human beings with our own limitations and our own someone said, you know, we are all running on the operating system. You know, even though we have evolved over thousands or hundreds of thousands of years, man still runs on Cayman 1.0. The operating system has remained the same, which means we have our selfish interests, our egos, and anything and everything to do with basic human nature, the animal instincts or the basic instincts. These have not changed. So we should also be aware that we are dealing with human beings, and it's not about the ideal scenarios that we are talking about. Like if I am working with someone, my intention is to make myself stronger. It is not about helping someone who is weaker. I mean, that comes next, along with making myself stronger. If I can help someone who is weak, that's fine. But again, that has to be appreciated. I'm not talking about everyone, but mostly that would be the case. And same is the case, you know, self-interest, if you want it to disappear just because we have a common goal and we are set out to solving the palliative care needs, or, you know, providing a solution for that, we can't imagine that all the people you're working with are going to come together and solve all these problems. It is not practical. Of course, there are one in a million, you know, people like this, the person we can see on the screen, who has dedicated his or her life only to this, you know, to the community, to serve the people, and nothing for himself or herself. But these are very, very rare, and we can't expect every other person to be a Mother Teresa or someone like her. And also, we have to understand that, you know, all this is fine. There are organizations who are willing to work together. There are people who are willing to come forward and support. But then we are still lacking one thing which is very critical, and that is a leader. Now, when I see a leader, this is the confusing bit, you know. We often, in our sessions, when we ask, you know, do you consider yourself a leader? Most of them, the answer is no. But the problem is the understanding about leadership. That is where the gap is. Mostly we imagine that unless we know the end-to-end, we have the solutions to all the problems that we see in palliative care, in implementing it, we cannot be a leader. Now, that is not the case. Leadership is something which every single one of us, we have got within ourselves, and we come out as leaders whenever the need arises. And we can see that happening in our own families, right? When there is a need to support the family, or, you know, someone falls ill, he or she needs to be taken to the hospital, immediately one of the persons available will take up that leadership role, take the decision, ensure that there is a support or this thing is made available, a vehicle is arranged for. Those kind of things automatically happen. Now, this happens within families, and it's not even the head of the family or a husband or a wife or a father or a mother who is actually taking the leadership. Sometimes it could be the children, depending on the situation. So it is more about being part of the team and identifying who has the capability to solve a particular situation, and letting them or helping them achieve that. Like, for example, if you're working with a team, you have two organizations working together, the leader should be the one who is able to identify what are the strengths in each of these organizations, what should be handled by who, and empower them to carry on with their respective roles. So it applies to groups, it applies to groups of organizations, and I strongly believe that there is a leader in each one of you. It's just that, you know, you have not put in that effort to bring out the leader in you. And if there is no leader, none of these things are going to happen. So, any collaboration, if you wait for something to happen, let the leader come through, let the organization take the leadership, and then when they're ready with all the required paraphernalia, I will come in and provide palliative care. Now, unfortunately, that is not going to happen. So each of these things, it starts with me, I. Now, I stands for a few things. The process starts with the inquiry. The inquiry When I say inquiry, it is about the questions that you ask yourself, like, what is it that I want to do? How is it that I want to do it? Why is it that I want to do this? Now, it is a very personal process of inquiry which happens inside. And I believe every one of us has to go through this process. Now, the most important question which needs an answer is why? Why do you want to do it? And probably everything else will fall in place. Now, once you're sure about why you want to do something, how you want to implement it, what is it that you want to do, all those things automatically comes through. And it also might involve innovation. When I say innovation, you can't expect a situation where everything is laid out for you and you just go there and do something. Like in the case of a patient care, if you imagine that there is the patient in front of you, opioids available, medical team available, the support team is available, and you take the car, drive to the patient home, and then provide home care. Now, that is not going to happen. Now, you may have some of these things. The rest of it is something which you will have to innovate and find a solution to. Maybe I can give you a small example which will help you understand the situation. Now, this actually happened in Calicut way back in the 90s again. So there was this guy who was talking to a doctor in the medical college, and a volunteer sees this, you know, this transaction happening, and he sees that, you know, at the end of the transaction, this guy goes back to a seat and he's dejected. Now the volunteer goes to him and asks, you know, what is the problem? He says, you know, I have a mother, my mother at home, who is 70 years old, and she is very sick. She needs medical help. So the volunteer asks him, you know, so what is the problem? You know, let us get medical help for her. So what did the doctor say? And he said, the doctor has asked me to bring my mother to the hospital. So the volunteer says, yes, then let us go bring her here. We'll arrange for an ambulance. Why should you don't have to worry about it. We'll take care of that. Then this guy says, no, it is not possible. Even if I want to do that, it is simply not possible. Because my mother stays at a place which is around 5 kilometers from here. And to reach the place, you have to cross at least 4 or 5 canals. And you know how the canals in interior parts of Kerala are. The only way to cross these canals are these wooden logs which are laid across these canals. And imagine my mother, who is around 70 plus kilograms, being transported across these canals to this medical college. It is simply impractical. It is not possible. 4 people need to carry her across these canals. It is not possible. So there ends the medical solution for that person, or so you would imagine. But this volunteer immediately reacted. What he said was, you can go home now. Don't worry about your mother. Doctor will reach your home. So for a volunteer, you know, he has innovated. You know what he did? He just asked one of the doctors, asked him to accompany him. He told there is a need in this particular location. He took his scooter, a two-wheeler, asked the doctor to join him behind him, and they went, crossed the bridges, reached the home. And there, that was the first palliative home care visit in the entire country. So the innovation was, you're not waiting for an entire team of doctors and nurses with home care visit vehicle to make that happen. Or even the concept of home care, a doctor reaching out to the patient, therein lies the innovation. And that will inspire people. And that is what inspired more people into palliative care in the coming years. And that is how it became a movement, a community-led palliative care movement in Kerala. And by the way, this person's name was Ashok Kumar, who is not known in many palliative care circles, but he was not even a graduate. So that also answers your other question about volunteer. You know, what do you need any qualifications? No. The heart is what is most important, and being able to innovate and think of new solutions. And once you are able to inspire the people around you, it's that is when you create that big impact. Next slide. And the impact goes from that individual, it affects the community around and the society at large. So this is kind of a ripple effect, what we're talking about. And then, next slide please. Can you guess what is the key to good collaborative understanding? I mean, collaborative working, it is about understanding what the other partners need. Now, hold on. Okay. And the only way to understand what the partners, other partners whom you're working with, what their needs are, is again active listening. That is what you have been trained in the, I believe the communication sessions have happened already. Now it's about listening. That is the only way to understand what the medical college needs, what the local NGO needs. Is there a possibility that we can satisfy their need and in turn, you know, ensure that we also reach our objective? Any questions around this? I think that was back. Yeah. Shall we move forward? Just two sessions and I mean two areas to cover. Then comes advocacy. Now, one major problem that all of us are going to face is lack of awareness. Because of which, you know, I'll give you a simple example. You go to someone for money to raise funds. The immediate question is, you know, what is it that you're trying to do? So we have to start explaining about palliative care, what is involved. Then the next thing is, you know, they start imagining, oh, palliative care. So that is mostly for people with terminal diseases, right? Or people with diseases which are incurable, okay? And most of your patients are going to be 60 plus, 70 plus, right? So the next thing what they are going to think about is, why should I put money on someone where the end result is not going to be, the outcome is not going to be positive? Now, unless that mentality, that thinking process is reversed, the same person will have the money. He may be comfortable spending that money on someone's education, where he sees that, okay, there is a future for the child, a family will be taken care of, but not in palliative care. The problem is not with him. The problem is with us. Unless we make sure that, you know, the community's attention is focused on this issue, make sure that it is not about them, it is about us, you and me included, then only we'll start seeing changes. So that is the reason why each one of us have to be advocates for this cause, irrespective of what role we play. We're not talking about three advocates on the field who go preaching around for palliative care. Each one of the doctors, nurses, social workers who are involved in palliative care need to take this up as their responsibility. And it helps. It helps change policies and practices. It can reform institutions, which is happening slowly but steadily. It has been a long journey, but NTPC is the National Program for Palliative Care. NDPS, you might have heard about it. It's the Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act, which was amended in 2014. And again, medical curriculum, nursing curriculum, all these things need to change, and they will need continuous work. It may involve years of hard work. Now, that is at the extreme end. I'm not saying everyone should focus on that. There is also a need for this kind of advocacy work at the local level, at the panchayat level, at the schools level, at every single level. The concept of palliative care, the importance of palliative care, these things have to be convey to people, and it also automatically helps in fundraising, because otherwise they wouldn't know why they are spending this money. Next. So this is something which you can all look at. We should be able to do at least some activity in some of these areas. It's only about being convinced about the need for palliative care and what it involves. It's about going out there and reaching out to these people or groups and spreading the message. Now, some of these may sound very silly, but I can guarantee you it is going to be very, very effective. Like for example, schools and colleges, where it goes into the youngster's mind and it has got a long-term impact. So we'll go forward. We are, yeah. So again, press and other media, they can help a lot. Once a report comes in a newspaper about an activity about palliative care, that helps us with the services, reach out to new people, get more volunteers and all those things. So if you move to fundraising, we'll stop in 5 minutes. We're just touching the basics here. Now, there are some misconceptions which we need to remove from our minds. Many people feel that, you know, fundraising is equivalent to selling. You are selling an idea and then asking someone for money, getting the money into your pockets. But the fact is, there are two different things. It is not about selling. It is not about selling anything for that matter. Because fundraising is about finding a solution for a cause that we are concerned about, which means the fundraiser, the person or the organization who is trying to raise the money, and the donor, which means the person who is donating, it could be an organization or an individual, they are on the same side. They are not like, you know, sitting across the table and negotiating or trying to sell something and, you know, have a transaction between them. It is about coming together and finding a solution for the suffering of the patient and the family. So it's not about the money, it is about finding solutions to their problems, and money, it just happens to be a means to meeting that end. And if you try to put in a lot of mission statement and organization strategies into it, I can guarantee you none of these is going to work, because people are focused on other people's needs, their suffering, their emotions. That is where they start supporting other people or the cause. So like I said, fundraising has to appeal first to the emotions, and that is when they will open their wallet. We cannot take out money from their wallets. We can only inspire them to give. That is their choice to come out and make this donation or support this cause. It applies to organizations, individuals, everywhere. So it has to be an open, honest approach where, as we discussed earlier, we are on the same team, which means there has to be an open communication. We share our successes as well as our failures, the problems, the challenges that we are facing, which means the supporter, the donor, will be with us throughout the journey. There may be pitfalls, there might be patients where you may not be able to achieve the things that you wanted to achieve, but then that is also something which needs to be shared with the person who is actually supporting us. And again, let us not forget that again, being a good listener is the key, because that is when you identify what the donor wants to give and when he wants to give. Let me reiterate here, we cannot force someone to give. He has to willingly feel the need to give and give. Okay? So now possible sources are many in front of us. Only thing is, each one requires a different skill set. If it is government grants, you need a different set of skills to access that, if it is corporate, like for example CSR programs, we keep hearing about it, you need a different skill set to write these project reports, approach these corporates for funding, and you know, maintain that relationship. There are high net worth individuals, there are individual donors, which might be easier to deal with at an individual level. But the other ones may require more skills, a teamwork, and of course, you can talk about events. We have seen that happening. You know, a musical night or a dance festival, where it is about raising funds, and it also helps advocacy, as we talked about earlier. So the awareness increases, it helps raise more funds also. Grants, campaigns, we have seen many of these things in action. Now, it is about imagining new things, trying out new things. Some of it may succeed, some of it may fail, but it has to start somewhere. And again, it starts with me. We cannot wait for someone else to come in and solve these problems for you. I think I'll close there. Dr. Sunil?
Thank you, Binod, for that very good session. I think this will be a new experience for most of the doctors. This is a new area where you have focused on volunteers, how to collaborate with others, and how to fundraise and advocate for palliative care. Thank you. Any doubts, anybody? So this is our last session. So please ask your doubts.
So since you are running out of time, in case you have doubts or other questions, feel free to communicate with Rajalakshmi. I'll be happy to, you know, give my inputs, whatever little I can. It can be over phone also. You can collect the phone number from her. So that is something which can be done later also. Thank you, Dr. Sandhya.
Jyoti has a question. She was asking whether she can contact us if she come across a patient who needs palliative care. Jyoti, you can contact us. One important thing that you need to know is Palliative India is operating for clinical services only in Trivandrum. But we have other national projects. But definitely we can help you where to contact, how to get the contact number, etc. So if you have a patient in nearby Trivandrum area, definitely we can directly involve in the patient care. But if you have a patient nearby your area, you can contact us, Rajalakshmi or me or any of us in Palliative India, so that we can help you to find out where the patient needs to go for palliative care. So there are many palliative care centers in Kerala. So you can also note that if you go to our website, www.palliativemedia.org, there is a directory of palliative care centers of India. So even you can point out where the patient needs to go. But definitely all of you can contact us if you have any doubts in palliative care. Anybody else? Krishnamar?
No, sir, nothing.
Thank you.
So, thank you, everyone. It was wonderful talking to you. I'm not sure about you, but I really enjoyed this session, and I hope it has been at least we've been able to throw some light on some of the important aspects. It's not like, you know, overnight we can do all these things and, you know, create magic, but it's just about getting an idea about what is involved and what would be the challenges going forward. So thank you very much once again. Thank you for giving me an opportunity, Rajalakshmi and Dr. Sunil. I look forward to having more interactions with you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for taking a session for us. And about the...
Rajalakshmi, before closing the session, I would like to get some feedback from the participants who attended this session. I think now Jyoti, Nihita, Krishnomar, Ammalu, so you can tell us how do you felt about this sessions and what were the shortcomings. Jyoti,
a few words.
I would like to hear from you. Please unmute Jyoti. Jyoti. Okay, Jyoti can't speak. Yeah, Jyoti, you can type.